Welcome to Palm City Church. We are so glad that you're here. And if you're on vacation, you got toes in the sand, or you're eating a rib right now at 10:30 in the morning, we're not going to judge you. We love you and miss you and can't wait for you to get back home. Come on, let's put our hands together and welcome everybody here. Yeah. We are glad that you're here today, and I am glad the iPad is strong, everybody. Praise God for that. But we're excited that you're in the room today. Happy 4th of July weekend. It's Independence Day. We're not a perfect country, but I'm really thankful that I live in the United States of America. I don't know about you. And I think that we need to remember that freedom is not free. We're going to talk about that today a little bit, but can we put our hands together for the men and women who serve our country faithfully, who are protecting our freedom right now all across the world, who have already given their lives perhaps so that we could be free today? It's a big deal. It's a big deal. And so happy Independence Day, weekend, holiday, however you say it. And we're super excited that you chose to be in church today. That's pretty awesome. I also want to make mention to a small fact. I always like to think about this personally, and I thought I would share it with you. It is the halfway point in 2022.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, those who said yeah are enjoying their year. And maybe that's you. Maybe, man, 2022 has been off the charts. You're living your best life, and we champion that. We celebrate that. We pray the second half is even better than the first, in Jesus' name. But we also know some of you here today may be facing the hardest year of your life. Maybe you're like, not so much for me. It's been really hard. And I would just encourage you today, if I may, that no one remembers the score at halftime. That you still got a lot of game yet to play, and you got a great coach and a God on your side that is going to take whatever happened, and somehow in His power, He's going to work it for your good. So hang in there, keep coming to church, keep serving, keep reading your word, keep praying, and trusting that God loves you and can get you through every situation victoriously by His name and in His power. Can I get a good amen, church?
Amen.
Amen. And then some of us here are just like, meh. You know, it ain't been bad, but it ain't been good. And I would just say to you that it's like this quote from C.S. Lewis that I love so much. It said, it's funny how day by day nothing changes. But when we look back, everything is different. And if you feel like it's just been mundane, like Monday rolls to Tuesday and the dishes are full again and the laundry is everywhere again, and I just drive to work and drive home again, that God is doing more in what seems to be mundane than you can ask, think, or imagine. And there's going to be a moment in the near future, I believe, where you look back and go, oh my gosh, God was doing more than I could think, ask, or imagine, and I'm just going to give Him praise for it. So don't be discouraged, whether it's been a hard year or whether it's just been kind of a meh year. Just know that God has your back and the best is yet to come. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Awesome. Well, we have one goal today. We didn't want to start a new series, really because we wanted to take a moment at this halfway point and just pause. I think it's important from time to time to not just rush through even things like church. It can unintentionally become yet another box on our list that we feel like we have to check off. And what if we just stopped today and recognized the faithfulness of God and all that's happened? And then what can we do to make sure we see continued faithfulness, not from Him, but from us in our life to Him for the remaining of this year and beyond. So our goal is that we would just draw one step closer to Jesus today. That seems pretty practical, right? Pretty palatable too. Okay, I may not can take all the steps, but I can take one. And specifically, we want you to take one step towards Him in this area the Bible talks about a lot called freedom. Now, it's Freedom Weekend in America. We'll talk about the difference of those in just a minute. But I'm talking about a different level of freedom. I'm talking about a spiritual freedom that God has available to you. Actually, I want you to say that word with me. Say freedom.
Freedom.
Now, come on, that's pretty good. But why don't you say it like Braveheart would?
Freedom.
I mean, if there's ever... That's Braveheart. If there's ever been a moment I want to paint my face blue and grow my hair out, it's that moment. Like, that we would just like be passionate and scream freedom. Because I believe that's the type of freedom God has for us. But I'm not talking about that type of freedom. I'm not talking about an emotion. I'm not talking about a country. I'm talking about a spiritual freedom. God is notorious all throughout Scripture, cover to cover, of taking people that were in captivity and setting them on a path of freedom. It is the heart of God, not just to save us, but to free us as well. Have you ever wondered, if I've given my life to Christ and I'm going to heaven, then why doesn't God just teleport me? Okay, God wants you to help others find what you have found. So God not only saves you, but he frees you. Because there's a principle in Scripture that says freed people, free people. That God wants you to be free so that you can help others find the freedom that you're currently living in spiritually. And the Bible, from cover to cover, talks about this. And he sent one guy to help do it in biblical times named Paul. Now, you may have been in church and you've heard this dude known as the Apostle Paul. But basically, that's a guy who plants a lot of churches. Paul was that guy. He was a church planter, which is a daunting task. I don't know as much as he did, but I know a little bit about it 6 months into a brand new church plant. You're going to an unchurched area, perhaps, where you're trying to bring different ethnicities and experiences and backgrounds, both spiritually and culturally and personally. And you're trying to unite them under the greatest name, the name of Jesus. That's not for the faint at heart. And so Paul had this mission, and that's our mission too, to try and take the beauty that exists in Wesley Chapel and the surrounding areas, and that in Jesus' name bring us all together, realizing there's more that makes us alike than makes us different. That's right. And so can we do that? Well, yeah, we can, but why would God want that to be the case? Because the Bible tells us in Acts 4 that salvation is found in no one else. Only the name of Jesus can save us, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind for which we should be saved. Only Jesus saves, but the question then becomes, well, why does Jesus save? And this is where we're going to land today. It's God's agenda for your life, freedom. Galatians 1:5:1a says this, says, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. You may want to underline that. You may want to circle that. Okay, it is not so that you would be a spiritual puppet. It is not so that you would follow a list of rules that Christ has set you free. No, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. That God, Jesus, left heaven to live a life on the earth, face everything you're facing, overcome everything that you would face, and actually not just overcome it, but defeat it, break the power and remove the barrier that existed between God and man so that we wouldn't just be saved by God through Christ, we would be freed by God through Christ. This is the gospel. Now, it's pretty important to think about different things of freedom. When I think about freedoms, I think about fireworks, right? Anybody? Anybody going to be blowing up some bottle rockets? Okay. Safety first. Wear your glasses. And kids, don't shoot them at each other. I think about fireworks. What about the level of freedom you just graduated high school? Come on. Come on, you're sitting here singing this song. You're like, I'm out of here. I'm free. But then you actually have to move back in, so you're not. There's different levels of freedom. Maybe it's that last day of school before summer vacation. Maybe it's that feeling you have of freedom at 5 o'clock on a Friday. Come on, somebody, it's 5 o'clock somewhere. Maybe it's paying off a credit card. Maybe it's the freedom financially when you pay off your car. You're like, yeah, that's my car. That's my car. Maybe it's the freedom you have when you pay off your house. I have no idea, but maybe you do. Maybe one day in Jesus' name. What about the freedom? Come on, parents, where are you at when you drop them kids off at the grandparents?
Let freedom ring. Let the white dove sing.
Come on. Let the white dove sing. See, that's the Holy Spirit getting involved. Not really. That's just Carrie Underwood. Maybe you don't have kids. Maybe it's when you drop the dog off at the kennel. I don't know. Maybe it's that. Or what about the sound of freedom? Have you ever heard of the sound of freedom?
And I'm proud to be an American. Come on. Where at least I know I'm
Come
free.
On, go back to second grade with me.
And I won't forget yeah. the men who died, who gave that
It is
right
for freedom that Christ has set us free. Cut the tape. Thanks, Lee Greenwood. We're done with you. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. I'm not talking about an emotion in a country. I'm talking about the spiritual freedom that Christ has provided for us. Now, I want to give you some good news today because sometimes we get in the wrong lane. Sometimes we're in the lane of trying to get free. No, you don't have to get free. God has already freed you in Christ. Christ has freed us. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. But we got to look at the B part of that same verse. Check it out on the screen. Galatians 5, 1b. Now that you're free, stand firm. Come on, say that with me. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. We've got to stand firm. So God frees us. That's his part. He's paid for our salvation, and he even spiritually helps us get free. But how many know getting free and staying free are two different things? That God wants us, now that you're free, stand firm in your freedom so that you don't return back to old patterns, old habits, and old lifestyle. Paul, in this book of the Bible that is six chapters, he spends the first four building up to this moment of chapter five. He begins talking about the captivity they had towards sin, the captivity they had towards a religious spirit, the captivity the Galatians had towards a worldly culture. And Paul comes along and goes, hey, you got to get free from that. Actually, Christ has already freed you, but your part is to stand firm in that freedom. Our goal and our vision for you at Palm City is that you would give your life to God. But that's not where it ends. Salvation is not the end point for you. Salvation is the starting point for you. We don't only want you to give your life to God. We want to teach you and walk with you as we figure it out ourselves and learn how to live for God. That is the vision of the church. Yes, give your life to Jesus. Best decision ever. But that is the starting point, and God has so much more for you to experience if you would just step into these next steps of freedom. Maybe you're here today and you feel a million miles away from God. You're like, yo, I would love to be free and stand firm in freedom, but I'm not free. I want you to know at the end of today's message, we're going to create a moment where you can have the opportunity to give your life to God. And some of you, if you've already made that decision, my encouragement to you is a little bit of the same, but a little bit of different, is now that you're free, stand firm in that freedom. Now, you may say, I've done that. I want to stand firm. Where do I stand? Did you know freedom has an address? 2 Corinthians 3 says this, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And so it teaches us in this text that freedom and lordship are connected. And just like a king has a kingdom, the Lord has lordship. Lordship is a domain. Lordship is an area of guidelines and boundaries that if we stay within them, we live under that lordship and can stay free in our relationship with God. Therefore, standing firm is living our lives in and under the lordship of Jesus, recognizing that true freedom is not free, recognizing that true freedom has boundaries. Now, some of you may have just checked out in that moment. Oh, boundaries. Oh. Restrictive. Boundaries. It's not that type of boundaries. Our thoughts on freedom in America, especially in the church, can be a little bit off of the true definition of Christ's freedom for us. We love independence, and that's good for a country, but that's awful for a Christian. That God doesn't want you to live independently, but he wants you to live in dependence on Jesus. It's a different mindset. Hey, we champion that America's free, and we say Independence Day, but it's not a good mantra for you to adapt for your own life. Some of us are here today, and we're living with no boundaries. Write that down if you're taking notes. We're living with no boundaries. Jesus did not go to the cross for our independence. Jesus went to the cross for our freedom. Not so that we could do things our way, but that we could know the truth, the life, and the way. That Jesus offers a freedom to us that no one can give you and no one can take from you. Your bank account can't purchase it. There's no man that can match it. And there's no clout or prestige in the earth that can contain it. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. But some of us are living outside the boundaries of what God has established for us. And it's not a safe place to be. Now, at our church, we don't condemn people who are at different places in their faith. But I am here to warn you today, if you're living without any boundaries, it's a dangerous posture to take. And if I truly love you and you were on a road driving to a destination, and I had information about that road that you could not see in this moment, and I did not tell you, I would not be your friend. So today I am trying to tell you, if you are living a boundary-free life, the road is out ahead. The bridge you think is there to help you get across this next season, it doesn't exist. And if you don't stop and change direction and turn your life another way, it's not going to work out good for you. And I mean that in love. Jesus even told us a story about this example in what we know is the prodigal son. Nobody wants to be a prodigal son. It's not a good title to have. I've been one. Okay, kind of went my own way, messed it all up. Thankful I had a praying mom and a graceful God for a second chance. Maybe that's your experience too. But we see in this story of Luke 15 that the younger son got together all he had. You see, there was two sons, and his dad had some things for him. It was some inheritance, some blessing, the things that were going to fill his heart, fill his life, and prosper him forward into his future. But he had a problem waiting on the father giving it to him at the right time. He had some tension, and he said, I want it all, and I want it now. And the father said, okay, it's not best for you, but I'll grant your request. And so the son gathered all he had, and he set off for a distant country. And there he squandered his wealth in wild living. The son squandered it all, everything he had that was going to set him up, that was going to set not only his family up, but it was going to be legacy for his entire lineage. He squandered in wild living, because I believe he had the same mindset as the people of Galatia when Paul planted the church there. And that's why Paul wrote the letter to them. He had a feelings first mentality. If it feels good, do it. It had the mantra of, I'm going to do me. Nobody tells me what to do. Nobody puts boundaries on my life. I'm going to do what I want to do. And that is demonic, honestly. The Bible talks about a word, hedonism. It's chasing sensual pleasure. It's being feelings led instead of choices led in your life. And the prodigal son showed that same lifestyle. The Greek word in that verse, 15:13, for wild living is the word asotos. It means indulgent in sensual pleasure or vices, living life with no restraints. Sounds like another city I know that has a mantra like that. Come on, Vegas, baby. What do we say? What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. That ain't true. The action may take place there, but the consequences are going to follow you home. And this, I don't know if you know this, but this actually came from a tourism problem Vegas had in the 90s. That no one was coming to the city, and so they got together and said, so many people want to get out of the boundaries God has placed for them. So many people want to live this unrestricted, free life. What if we created a place that had the illusion of freedom, and it fed into the desire for escapism that we all fight and battle from time to time? What if we created this place called Vegas, that what happens here stays here? And so they did. But how many know freedom isn't free? That there is a price for that wild living, and that's what the son in the prodigal son story experienced. Now, that wild living may be fun for a season. Come on, who's had a season or two of some things that kind of go against God's word? I'm going to be the first to say, I haven't had a perfect life, but I'm thankful for the grace of God, because that season ends. Sin may be fun for a season, but that season's going to end, and you're going to be left like the prodigal son in a mess. The Bible says he was in a pig pen. Here's a guy who had big money, big talent, big dreams, maybe even just, you know, big purpose in his life. And he took the very thing that was there to propel him, and he used it for something that ended up putting him in bondage. And he found himself stuck, because there's always a price to our choices. Oh, you don't believe me? Have you ever been to a buffet? Come on, somebody. It has the illusion of freedom. I can eat all the steak, all the fixings I want, and then I can bury myself in soft serve ice cream. Who wouldn't want this? I'm free, no restrictions, no limits. But how many have paid the price for buffet life? you've gotten home and you're like, dad bod, brought to you by Buffet Life. Maybe you've experienced a food coma. Anybody had a food coma? I'm just on the couch asleep for 2 or 3 hours because I've indulged myself in my sensual pleasures at Golden Corral. I would never eat Golden Corral. Shout out to Golden Corral. But that's the life that we find ourselves in, where we think that having no limits is freedom, and that's not God's freedom for us. We can't live with no boundaries. Some of us, maybe we're here today, and it's not that we have no boundaries, we just have our own. So we've taken the position of, I know what's right. No one tells me what to do. I make the decisions on how relationships look. I make the decisions on what I do with money. I make the decisions on what I say, where I go, and what I look like, because I get to decide what's right and wrong in my life. Well, if that's you and you're following Jesus, you're really not. You're following yourself. You're not serving God. You've made yourself a God. This is a dangerous place to be too, because we are never supposed to have the lordship and authority to set the boundaries for our own life. This is a dangerous place for us to be. I want to illustrate it through my friend Nemo. Come on, do you guys know Nemo? Look at him. He's cute. He's just swimming. Best life. Now, you may be looking at him and going, that's not fair. He shouldn't be in that bowl. He deserves more. He should be free. Well, who says? We have to let the one who designed it define it. You may say, well, that's not fair. He has to swim all the time. Well, he has fins, not feet. It's actually best for him. You may say, oh, man, it's so sad. He's got to hold his breath underwater. Well, he doesn't have lungs. He has gills. That's actually the best design for him. How many times in our life do we look at something and go, oh, that's not fair. I should have more. I deserve more. No one should put a restriction on how you feel, think, or act, because that's not freedom. But Christ comes along and says, oh, yeah, there's boundaries for you. Actually, there's a psalm that says the boundary lines have fallen in pleasant places. That's the goal for our life, that we would see the boundaries that God has given us as a place to keep us free, not bound. Christ doesn't give you boundaries to keep you bound. You know the kingdom's upside down. Christ gives you boundaries to keep you free. This is the scripture that we see, but we see things wrongly sometimes, me included. We have the wrong perspective, and that's why Proverbs 14 says, there is a way that appears to be right, but in the end, it leads to death. It appears unfair for Nemo to be in the water all the time, but if you got him out of the water, he's not free. He's dead. There's a way that seems right, but in the end, leads to death. Now, I don't want to over-spiritualize this moment, but when I was praying and preparing for our time together, I felt like the Lord gave me the phrase, ask them to look again. Is there a way that you're looking at things that appears to be right, but maybe the Spirit of God is saying, look again? Maybe it's in your workplace, some of the communication and conversations you've stepped into that maybe aren't the best and doesn't really promote a culture of honor, doesn't really reflect well on Christ, and you've justified it by saying, this is okay for me to do. Look again. Maybe it's that relationship that you've started or that has presented itself, and on the surface, it looks like it's okay. But the Holy Spirit may be saying, look again. Maybe that DM that slid in seems innocent, but maybe you should look again. I'm here to tell you there's a way that appears right in our life from time to time. But in the end, if it's not God's best for our life, it can lead to death. There's no real freedom in living within our self-defined boundaries or living without boundaries at all. Real freedom happens when we live within God's boundaries. Can I get a good amen? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Freedom and lordship are connected. And that God gave us boundaries not to restrict us or restrain us, but his boundaries are set to release us. That it's actually opposite of what the world would tell you they're there for. And my question to you today is, if you don't see it that way, who told you following God is restrictive? My question for you today, if you don't believe that, is who told you a life of Christ is boring and dull and that somehow God will limit the quality of your experiences? Who told you that? I want to come along as a friend today and say, you better check the source. If you were to ask me what it's like to be pregnant, and I told you, and you believed me, you better check the source. This brother ain't never been pregnant. How many times are we listening to people who don't have experience in taking what they say as truth, when truth has already been established? It's not up for debate. It's not abstract in nature. It is a firm foundation that we can build our life on. We better check the source, that God has more for us than we're thinking, and that we better check the sources that we're giving ear, eye, mouth, experience, time, talent, resources to. Check the source. Check the source. A man who has an experience is never at the mercy of a man who has an argument. And I don't have an experience in a lot of things, but I have an experience with God, that He has saved me, forgiven me, changed me, healed me, restored me, purposed me, put my feet on solid ground, given me an opportunity to serve people. And if He's done it for me, He'll do it for you. I'm living my best life. Is it perfect? No. Do I have a great marriage? No. I have a good one and a godly one, and I'm working on it every day. And it's not perfect, but it's good, and it has purpose. And we know why we exist, and we know why we're on the earth. And I'm telling you, if you know those two things, everything else seems to fall in place. We better check the source of where we're giving our attentions to and trust that God has given us boundaries that keep us free, not keep us bound. The Apostle Paul goes on to say in 1 Corinthians, he said this, "You say, I have the right to do anything, but not everything is beneficial." You may say, "I have the right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything." So there's certain freedoms throughout the life of a Christian that you may have that I don't have. I'm not your Holy Spirit, but I'm here to tell you, if it's pulling you away from God, it's not God's best for you. If you can do it and it pushes you closer to God, maybe you can. But is it beneficial that you do it even though you can? Paul's filter was always other people. That was his filter. And so in looking at his life, I want to create for us a freedom filter, a way that we can check the source, a way that we can take the things that we're making decisions on and actions we're stepping into, and we can decide, is this really freeing me? Is this really helping me stand firm? Is this really a good example of God? Is this really an example of Christ's witness? Or is this something I can do, but I probably shouldn't because it hurts that brother? Is this something I should do, but I probably shouldn't because it impacts the testimony I have with this sister? Am I free to do it, or should I do it? If you're taking notes, I want you to write these three filters down. Number one, is it pleasing to God? John 8 says, "To the Jews who had believed, Jesus said, 'If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.'" The first question we have to answer in the freedom filter, the litmus test of our life from an action and a choice standpoint, if the Bible is unclear on it, is the area of, does this please God? Without faith, it's impossible to please God, so you have to be able to do it in faith. We'll talk about that in just a moment. But the Bible also tells us all throughout Scripture what God's boundary lines are. God's perfect will and His infallible word kind of put up the borders of our life where there is complete freedom, autonomy, joy, peace, happiness, all in that little pasture. It's fun to run and gallop and sprint all within those boundaries. But you need to look at the Bible. That's the book for me. It's God's truth. That is your filter of knowing if it's pleasing to God or not. And the Bible, I want to break this myth for some of us, is not just devotional. It's practical. God gave it to us as a manual for our everyday life, that we would find nuggets to not just be inspired on a platform on Sunday. That's so baseline, and I hope that happens. But there's so much more when you read the Word. God will speak to you in the questions you're asking. God will meet you with decisions on things you've been grappling with. The Holy Spirit, in a still, small voice, if you will get practical and devotional with His Word, will come in and speak to you and give you clarity and direction. And He will say, "This is the way. Walk in it." The first filter we have to answer, though, is this pleasing to God? God's word is not for condemnation, but for preparation. That's why 2 Timothy says this, the whole Bible, come on, say that, the whole Bible was given to us by inspiration from God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It straightens us out and helps us do what is right. It is God's way of making us well prepared at every point, fully equipped to do good to everyone. It is not for condemnation. The Bible doesn't tell you what's wrong with you and just leave you hanging like that. No, the Bible shows you areas of your life that don't line up to God's boundary lines for you, that don't line up to God's best for you. And then it points you in a way to prepare you so that you can live your best life, freedom in Christ, and not only live free, but stand firm in that freedom if we know first, does this please God? Number two, does it uphold my convictions? Romans 14, 23, Paul said, but if you have doubts about whether or not you should eat something, you are sinning if you go ahead and do it. Here's the statement. For if you are not following your convictions, if you do anything you believe is not right, you are sinning. So if you can't do it in faith, don't do it. It's sin. Now, Paul, in context here, was talking about food because there was pagan food that was sacrificed to idols. And Paul was like, man, this is God's pig. I don't care what they've done with it. I'm free to eat it. So if you can't eat it in the same type of faith, you probably shouldn't. But the same principle applies today, that the filter needs to be, does it pass the convictions of the Holy Spirit in your life? Now, God's word is perfect, but the Apostle Paul and us need to have our own set of personal convictions. Things that we may feel we're free to do, but are we convicted not to for the witness that God has given us to others? How do you know? How do you know if a personal list of convictions is just the burritos you ate last night or they're God's word? Here's the truth. God-inspired convictions will never contradict God's word. Can you find the conviction you feel the Holy Spirit has given you in God's word? If you find that truth there, it's pleasing to Him, and you can line up Scripture with it and it meets your convictions, that's your second freedom filter in a life of living for Christ that is not just getting saved and going to heaven one day, but is freeing and helping others find the same freedom. The last one, if you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. Number three is this. Does it represent God's love? This is very important. The Bible says Christ has made you an ambassador. So you are labeled Christ follower, and you are God's plan for the earth. There is no plan B. God's made the way. He's removed the barrier between you and God through Christ so that you could have relationship with Him, and in Christ you could live free. And God's not coming back to do a do-over. He did it once, and He did it perfectly. But it's our opportunity to step into that because we are Christ ambassadors. As though, the Bible said, God is making His appeal to the earth through us. And so we need to know, yeah, maybe I can do it. Maybe I don't have a conviction about it. But does this represent God's love to others? Does this go against what they believe and mess them up in the grand scheme of their pursuit of a relationship with God? Jesus knew His mission. The Bible says Jesus came to serve and to give His life a ransom for many. And just like freedom's connected to lordship, freedom's also connected to mission. One of the best ways you can stay free in your spiritual walk is to know the mission God's given you. Jesus knew His. Do you know yours? That your life is not your own any longer. The Bible says you've been bought with a price, that Christ has put purpose in you and given you power in His name and has promised to put His hand on you so that you have His presence in your home as a mother, in the school place, wherever your sphere of influence is. That is where God wants you to represent His love, that you would live a life in a way that helps others step into the freedom God has for them. Paul did it because he said this in 1 Corinthians 9. Though I am free and belong to no one, I've made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. His filter became, it may be okay for me, but since it's not good for you, and because I live a life of love, I will lay down my right in order to serve you. I will lay down the freedom I have in order to step in and meet you where you are so that I don't be a hindrance to what God wants to do in your life. It's a selfless approach. This says, stand firm in your freedom by knowing if it's pleasing to God, by making sure it upholds your convictions that you then filter through God's word, and then by making sure your actions, choices, and decisions all represent the love of God. It's honestly why we have the growth track. You probably hear me talk about the growth track quite often, and I'm going to continue because I believe in it. I believe I can't pastor all your problems, because as soon as I do, you're going to get a new list, and that's going to be the rat race for eternity. But if I can give you something in your life bigger than your problems, if I can help you find purpose and your unique expression to the body of Christ, that you would know for such a time as this, I am made, and I am too a part of the body that can help the overall body function, then your life will stay free as you stay on mission, knowing while you're on the earth. It's not just to work 40 hours a week. It's not just to take care of some kids and hopefully keep them alive and get them to college and let them move back in again and then let them leave again. Those are all important things. But your life is ultimately the combination of knowing Jesus and then making him known. That's the purpose and the key to all of our lives. That will we live that way, because Paul ends it in Galatians 5:13 with this thought: for you've been called to live in freedom. But don't you use your freedom to satisfy your own sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. And if you do that, here's the promise of Jesus. Jesus replied to them in John 8 and said, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has a permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you'll be free indeed." My question for you today is, are you free? We're going to pray a prayer in just a minute that gives you an opportunity to experience the freedom of Christ through a relationship with him. But then if you are free, if you've already made that decision, my question to you today is, are you standing firm in that freedom? Or are there some areas of compromise you've allowed to come in just due to what's happened in the last 2 or 3 years? Or maybe even the first half of this year, and you've just kind of stepped away and the lines are now blurry. You love Jesus, you're at church, obviously, but you're not free. You're in bondage today, and I believe the Son wants to set you free so that you will be free indeed. Would you bow in prayer? Father, we pray for every person here that may need a relationship with you. We pray for every person here that feels like they've found themselves in a pig pen. They're living at a level, God, you never intended them to live based on some choices they've made, or maybe even some choices they didn't have control over. Today we know in the story of the prodigal son, there was a moment where the Bible says the son came to his senses and he realized, I don't have to stay where I am. That I can go home to a father who doesn't condemn me, but who loves me. The Bible says the son came to his senses and said, I'm going back to my father's house. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Can I say to you today, come home? Can I say to you today that God doesn't judge you or condemn you based on the choices you've made, but he's made a way through his son Jesus to allow you to come back in right standing with him? If that's you today and you want to get your heart right and your relationship right with Christ for whatever reason, maybe you've made this decision before, no one's looking around, this is a private moment where you can have an opportunity for a father to welcome you back home. If that's you today, I'm going to pray a prayer that you can join in with me. The power's not in some ritualistic repeating of the words. The power is, I'll help you with the words, but you saying this from your heart to God. If that's you today and you want to be included, on the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. You You can slip it up, slip it right back down very quickly and very privately as no one's looking around. This is your moment. But I would ask you and encourage you to step into it. If you want to start or restart a relationship with Jesus today, you know you're not as free as you once were, or you're not as free as you hope to be, and that you know God has more for you, and you're tired of the mental battle, you're tired of living life in your own strength, and you're ready to step into the freedom Christ has for you. One, two, three. I want you to raise your hand if that's you today. Awesome. One. Yeah. Great. Slip it right back down. Let me help you with some words. Say, Jesus, today forgive me. Today come into my life and transform me. I'm not here to check spiritual boxes. I'm here to do business with you as you did on the cross for me. Today come into my life. Forgive me of my sin. Set me free by the power of your name. And by the power of your blood, I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Father, I pray for every person here. Lord, whether we've been a Christian 5 seconds or we've been following you 50 years, there's always another level of freedom you want us to experience. Lord, we don't want to stay where we are. We want to move on, as the Bible says, from grace to grace, from glory to glory. We want to take next steps in order to fulfill the mission at which you've sent us. So Lord, help us this week, today, maybe this afternoon on a walk with our wife, maybe Monday morning at the office before emails, sometime this week, help us to grapple with the decisions of freedom again. Is what I'm doing pleasing to you? Does this uphold a list of convictions inspired by the Holy Spirit and in alignment with your word? And do my actions represent your love in its purity and in its grace? And we thank you, God, for helping us always not be better than each other, but be better than ourselves. And we pray these things in Christ's name. And everybody said amen. Amen. Can we put our hands together for those who made a decision today?